One thing's pretty much for certain in our increasingly unpredictable modern world, and that's that now we've discovered it and found out how unbelievably useful it is, we humans are extremely unlikely to be giving up electricity anytime soon. And that means we have to keep making stuff happen at a fairly massive industrial scale all over the world in order to keep the juice flowing, so to speak. If we leave aside batteries and capacitors, which use clever chemistry to make electrons flow, and solar panels, which are just God's way of messing with our minds, then we're essentially left with the relatively straightforward challenge of persuading a very strong magnet to rotate inside a coil of copper wire, or vice versa, in order to induce an electromagnetic force which gets the electrons in the wire all excited and gives them a bunch of energy that can then be pushed along the electrical grid and into your kettle or PlayStation or whatever. So you need to find ways to make things spin. Here's one way. In hell!
Full scale, sorry.
Very funny. Now scale it down, please. Wasn't hard, was it? Wind turbine. Here's another one. Hydroelectric power. Or you can extract massive quantities of carbon-rich fossil fuels from the ground and set fire to them in order to heat up a similarly massive quantity of water so that it makes steam so that you can force that across a turbine. And of course, for well over 100 years, that's been our very favourite way of making electricity. It's extremely reliable, and for a long time there seemed to be absolutely no limit to the amount of raw material available. And then we realised that the carbon dioxide released as a result of the burning of all that raw material has heated up our atmosphere so much that it's now jeopardising the future of most species currently living on our planet, including our own. So what we've been witnessing in the last few decades is a gargantuan global power struggle between the fossil fuel industry and the renewable energy industry. And sitting somewhere in the middle of all of that, quietly producing almost unimaginable quantities of more or less carbon-free electricity, have been the world's nuclear power stations. Hello, and welcome to Just Have a Think. We're back in the virtual studio this week to give ourselves a bit more space to look at a potential game changer in nuclear power generation. We all know about nuclear waste and Hiroshima and Nagasaki and meltdowns at Three Mile Island and Chernobyl and Fukushima. All of those events were awful, and all of them have undoubtedly tainted public perception of nuclear energy to a point where it might even struggle to keep its place in the electricity generation market as we make our way through the 21st century. The people that work in the nuclear industry are all pretty miffed about any such possibility, and that's because they know that a kilogram of uranium-235, which is the current nuclear fuel of choice, is capable of releasing many thousands of times more energy than a kilo of coal. And they also know that the reaction that takes place to release that energy doesn't release any emissions of carbon dioxide. And despite the three very prominent accidents that I just mentioned, the overall historical operational safety record of nuclear power is actually very good. So you could say that the biggest challenge the nuclear folks face is combating the almost universally adverse public perception of their entire industry, which I imagine they must find quite irritating. Now, this next bit gets a bit sciencey, and I'm not a scientist, as many of you remind me each week. So let's just give it a go and see how we get on. This is the periodic table, starting with the lightest element, hydrogen, up there. As you get further down the table, you get elements with more and more protons, until you get right down there, where you find uranium with 92 protons. Uranium occurs naturally in two different isotopes, uranium-235 and uranium-238, which are essentially variations of the element with different numbers of neutrons. Uranium-235 has 143 neutrons, and uranium-238 has 146 neutrons, which is where their atomic mass unit numbers come from. Uranium-238 is by far the most common of these two naturally occurring isotopes. Most nuclear reactors use refined uranium ore as a fuel because uranium-235 is fissile, which means it can be hit by a neutron and made to split up and release very large amounts of energy. But because most of the uranium ore is the 238 variety, which is not fissile, a great deal of extra energy has to be used to enrich the stuff they call yellow cake to increase the proportion of uranium-235 so that fuel is useful. The mixture still has loads of uranium-238 in it though, and that stuff is what's known as fertile, which means instead of breaking apart when it gets hit by neutrons, it absorbs a neutron and transforms into nasty waste products like weapons-grade plutonium-239. And that's why this kind of reaction is called a uranium-plutonium cycle. As a uranium-235 gets hit by a neutron and starts splitting and releasing its energy, it also releases more neutrons, which then go flying around all over the place. If those neutrons hit other uranium-235 atoms, then you get a chain reaction. And if you don't bother to control the chain reaction, you get a nasty meltdown and eventually a fairly unpleasant explosion and radioactive fallout blowing across large areas. And you don't want that. The typical configuration of a nuclear reactor is a bunch of solid uranium fuel pellets inside fuel rods surrounded by large amounts of water at very high pressure. The pressurized water acts as the moderator and the coolant to stop the chain reaction overheating. And as it gets superheated by the reaction in the fuel rods, it generates the very high pressure steam needed to drive the turbines and make the electricity. Good old water. It's the gift that just keeps giving. But once that uranium-235 chain reaction's been kicked off by the neutron bombardment, it's not going to stop for a very long time, and there's nothing much you can do about it except actively and relentlessly manage the water cooling process to keep things safe. And any disruption in that function, and you've got a big problem. In all three of the nuclear accidents at Three Mile Island, Chernobyl and Fukushima, it was the problems somewhere in the water cooling systems that caused the catastrophic failures. And of course, the waste from uranium nuclear reactors, including that weapons-grade plutonium, stays dangerously radioactive for tens of thousands of years. So if you could remove the long-term radioactive waste storage problem and the short-term global security risk from the plutonium, then most people would agree that that would be a good thing. And if you could also find an alternative to all that highly pressurized water in the system, then you'd eradicate the possibility of steam explosions and potential generation of flammable hydrogen gas. And that's a pretty useful factor of safety that the industry would dearly love to be able to sell to us consumers. As far back as the 1960s, nuclear physicists and engineers were working on an alternative nuclear energy system that they hoped would achieve exactly those outcomes. It was called a molten salt reactor, and instead of using uranium as a fuel source, the designer's plan was for it to use thorium instead. Thorium's right down there in the heavy section of the periodic table, very close to uranium, with 90 protons and 142 neutrons. In a molten salt reactor, instead of using solid uranium fuel pellets inside fuel rods surrounded by highly pressurized water, the thorium fuel is dissolved directly into superheated molten salt, which then acts as the coolant and provides convective heat, which goes through a heat exchanger to drive the turbine. Thorium is not fissile, but it is fertile, which means in a molten salt reactor, it absorbs a neutron and goes through a series of reactions that transforms it into a fissile material, specifically an isotope of uranium called uranium-233. Uranium-233 splits very nicely. In fact, when it splits, it releases more neutrons than uranium-235, and that tends to make the chain reaction more efficient. And you don't get any annoying uranium-238 in a molten salt reactor either, which means almost all the fuel is being utilized to generate energy. As a result, you potentially get a higher energy output per unit of fuel from thorium-uranium cycles than you do from an existing uranium-plutonium cycle. Then there's a safety side of thorium reactors. Because thorium is not fissile, no matter how many thorium nuclei you pack together, they won't continue their chain reaction after the initial bombardment of neutrons. That means, unlike uranium reactors, if you want to stop the process, you just stop firing the neutrons and the whole process shuts down. And because the fuel and the coolant are a liquid mixture, that liquid can be fed into the reactor more or less constantly without the costly and hazardous shutdowns required to replace spent solid fuel in uranium power plants. Molten liquid also expands as it gets hotter, so if there's a system failure and it gets too hot, then the fissile material gets spread too far apart to continue a chain reaction, and the process shuts down without the need for human intervention. But as an extra failsafe, the engineers designed in a freeze plug below the reaction chamber so that if you did get an overheat situation, the freeze plug just melts and the molten liquid drains out into a safe storage vat where the neutrons can't reach, and again the process shuts down automatically. So in theory, it's impossible to have a runaway meltdown accident, and because there's no pressurized water, there's no longer any risk of a hydrogen explosion from pressurized steam release. And on top of that, in its basic form, almost all naturally occurring thorium is thorium-232, which is exactly the isotope that can be used in nuclear reactors. Uranium ore only contains 3-5% of useful material, which, according to the enthusiastic proponents of molten salt reactor technology, means that thorium could potentially offer as much as 250 times the overall energy output of uranium and about 4 million times the energy of coal. A thorium-uranium cycle doesn't produce any of that rather inconvenient weapons-grade plutonium as a waste product either. And although waste from thorium reactors is still very dangerously radioactive, there's far less of it, and it only stays radioactive for a few hundred years instead of tens of thousands. Thorium's also pretty abundant. There's 3 times as much thorium in the Earth's crust as there is uranium, and it can be dug straight out of the ground in a pretty standard mining process. Some estimates say that if we did find a way to mine and fission thorium on an industrial scale, then about $100 worth per person would provide each of us with our entire lifetime's energy needs. All sounds a bit too good to be true, doesn't it? So why didn't we build molten salt thorium reactors when we first got busy with nuclear power back in the 50s and 60s? Well, one of the most popular theories is that uranium stole the march on thorium back then precisely because one of its waste products was weapons-grade plutonium, and during the height of the Cold War insanity, our world leaders decided that that'd be quite a useful byproduct. That story may be true, or it may be a total load of conspiracy theory codswallop. Doesn't really matter. Whatever the reason, molten salt reactors just didn't take off back then. And they remain no more than a theoretical concept today. No molten salt reactors are currently in commercial operation anywhere in the world. But 8 years after the Fukushima disaster, the nuclear industry is once again stepping bleary-eyed out into the bright light of public scrutiny to have one more go at world energy dominance. In recent years, there's been renewed excitement about molten salt reactors, and particularly a variety called liquid fluoride thorium reactors, or LIFTR for short. Right now, at the beginning of 2020, there are at least 20 research centres racing to achieve a commercially viable liquid fluoride thorium reactor proposal, including the United States, Japan, Denmark, France and Russia. China and India have huge quantities of easily available thorium, so it's an extremely attractive option for them as well, and one that both countries are actively researching and developing. A pragmatist might point out that while here in the West we're all busy removing meat from our diets and sticking solar panels on our roofs and rushing out to buy electric vehicles to minimise our carbon emissions, all our efforts are being cancelled out by the exponential economic rise and rapidly increasing energy demands of developing nations like China and India, the majority of which is currently being powered by coal. So you could argue that if new LIFTR reactors in those countries helped reduce the burning of fossil fuels to power their economic development, then maybe we should be looking at them much more seriously. But the technology remains unproven at commercial scale, with many technical challenges, not least of which is the chronic corrosion problem caused in the system pipework by the long-term exposure to the molten salts. The nuclear industry is very conservative by nature. It spent decades honing its safety systems and procedures to make failures like Three Mile Island and Chernobyl close to impossible in modern reactors. The industry and its regulators look on the new molten salt proposals with considerable scepticism, and getting licenses approved for those new power plants may prove to be an almost insurmountable hurdle. The development and construction costs, even for well-established and proven nuclear power plant technologies, have historically been extremely high, and projects have experienced very long delays. And then there's the glaringly obvious question of why we're not just throwing every available resource we have at renewable technologies. Even without subsidies, the cost of these technologies is now lower than most fossil fuel electricity generation. Battery storage technology combined with smart electrical grids distributed across different continents and time zones look like they have the potential to create very stable, well-balanced energy provision for the vast majority of the planet if we adopt them multilaterally. The really big investors are watching those cost curve graphs of renewable technologies versus traditional energy producing technologies flipping so quickly now that you'd need to be a very brave billionaire to sink your winnings into any nuclear power plant construction project, let alone a completely alternative, commercially unproven technology. There are some though, and one of them is Bill Gates, so we may well come back and check out exactly what he's up to in a later program. Arguably, it comes down to this though. The IPCC tell us we have less than 11 years to get our act together and put extremely robust measures in place to bend the carbon emission curve rapidly towards zero by 2050 and hopefully limit our planet's atmospheric warming to somewhere between 1.5 and 2 degrees above pre-industrial levels. Is 11 years enough time to design, develop, test, license, construct, and commission a new wave of nuclear power generation plants on a scale that might significantly contribute towards the eradication of fossil fuels? Or do we plough on with the renewable energy strategy instead? It's certainly a very contentious and divisive debate. No doubt you've got a view on the subject, and as always, I look forward to finding out your thoughts in the comments section below. That's it for this week though. Just time to say a huge thank you to all the folks who joined the growing team at our Patreon page since our last programme, and give a shout out to those people who recently started supporting the channel at $10 a month or more. They are Mike Jones, Vijaydev Ramdev, William Halford, Jackson Blythe, and Anders Helmar. If you want to get involved in the Just Have a Think project and help influence the content of the channel through 2020 and beyond, then visit our page at www.patreon.com/justhaveathink. You can also support the channel absolutely for free by liking this video and sharing it with your social media networks. And most important of all, the best show of support is to subscribe to the channel and hit the bell icon so that you help raise our profile with the YouTube search algorithms to get the message of climate change mitigation out to as many people as possible. You can do that really easily by clicking down there or on that icon there. As always, thanks very much for watching, have a great week, and remember to just have a think. See you next week.